All right, you guys ready to dive in? All right, Bible over your head. Holy Spirit, you've been here in such a powerful and unique way. We thank you that you live in our hearts, and we know you do, but we sure love when you show up in special ways like this morning. And I thank you for the freedom that has taken place and the people that have given their lives to you this weekend. We rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, there was a young man, I don't know how old he is, 6, 7, 8 maybe, that gave his life to Jesus in the 9 a.m. service. And so isn't that awesome? You guys celebrate that real quick with a clap. Well, I'll try not to take too much of your time, but I feel like this message is super important, okay? If you were here last week, then you know that Pastor Marvin shared a message with you called It's 3 O'Clock Somewhere. And it was a really good message out of Acts chapter 3. I encourage you, go back and watch or listen. This week, I want to go back to Acts chapter 2 and share a message with you called Church It Up. Church It Up. And what I want to tell you this weekend is we won't have the church we want until we become the church that he wants. And by he, we mean Jesus. Okay, write those things down. We won't have the church that we want until we become the church that he wants. Okay, so church it up. Now, I don't want to confuse anybody because I know most of the time you'll hear me say, don't church it up. Right? Like, don't make something sound better than it is. Don't exaggerate who you are or something you've done. All right? I was valedictorian in my class. It's like, bro, you were homeschooled. What are you even talking about? Don't church it up. Don't church it up. You guys with me? Now, listen, when it comes to our faith, when it comes to following Jesus and becoming the child of God that he has called us to be, I want to tell you, you gotta church it up. You have to magnify or amplify your involvement. You have to exaggerate your connection with the church. Now, I understand that exaggerate sounds like kind of a negative word. And the first definition of it is because that means to inflate the facts, to make something sound better than it actually is, right? So churching it up, okay? In that respect, yeah, it's a negative thing. It's like when we say, I caught a fish and it was this big. It's like, no, it wasn't. It was a minnow. Right? We all understand that definition of exaggerate. We can be tempted to exaggerate in our faith too, can't we? And we don't want to do that. We don't want to say that we are all about Jesus, that we're going for God when we're not. We're actually happily engaged in gross and blatant sin. And we don't want to do that because that's hypocrisy, right? And none of us want to be hypocrites. Another definition of exaggerate, though, is a little more positive because it just means to enlarge or increase, especially beyond the normal. Well, that's positive. We want to go beyond the normal of a thing, right? It can also mean to overemphasize. I used to give a lot of music lessons. I gave drum lessons and guitar lessons, and I would teach students to over-exaggerate movements. Like if you're learning to play the drums, well, really all you got to do is this. You know, you're teaching them to do this. But I would have them exaggerate that so that they would learn a little better about what that movement means. If there was a guitar player, you know, you learn the chords, but then you got to learn how to change from chord to chord. So maybe you're going from a G to a D. Well, that's not an easy change when you first learn. And so I would teach them how to do it, but exaggerate that change. Exaggerate that change. Now, notice you've never seen these guys up here doing that, like, oh, oh. That's because they've done the hard work. They've done the heavy lifting. But I used to teach kids to exaggerate those chords. By exaggerating those movements, you are reinforcing the basics of the how to do it and the why to do it and even the when to change those chords. My conviction, based upon personal experience and then even biblical precedent, is that when we church it up, when we enlarge or increase our involvement with church, it affords us a greater opportunity to learn and grow in the whens and the wheres and the hows and the whys of living for Jesus. Do you guys understand what I'm saying? And most of us totally understand that there are seasons of life when we don't just need to emphasize the importance of church. We need to overemphasize biblical community because it's a tough season. There's something hard going on in our lives, and more than ever, we need to church it up. Can I get an amen? So this message is a very pro-church message. And I recognize that I'm sharing it with a very pro-church group of people. Like, I know you love church. You love this church. I love that. But this is where we're at in our journey through the book of Acts. And so taking a look at how the early church did things might be helpful to anyone here who has not been very pro-church. Before we dive in, I want to point out that a very popular conversation among Christians over the, I would say, the last couple of decades is that we need to get back to a Acts 2 model of doing church. Like, we need to do church like the early church does. The church has really drifted and needs to function more like the early church. Now, I don't disagree with that, okay? But that is a huge conversation with lots of cultural caveats, meaning there are certain aspects of today's culture that 100% keep us from being able to function exactly like the early church. And to ignore those cultural caveats would be foolish and could even lead to disillusionment. That's why I always say that methods of doing are way less important than motivations for being. Amen, saints? Methods of doing are important, but methods of doing are way less important than motivations for being. And that's why we won't have the church that we want to have until we become the church that he wants. Okay, so let's dive in. Acts chapter 2. While we're going through this portion of scripture, I'm going to give you seven things that Jesus wants the members of his church to do, okay? Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter was just filled with the Holy Spirit and preached a powerful message, okay? We spent 2 weeks talking about the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit is, what his role is in our lives, what it means to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You can go back and you can watch those just a couple weeks ago. But literally just moments after Peter received the Holy Spirit, he stands up in front of thousands of people and he preaches the gospel. We don't have time to go through his whole sermon there, but look what it says in Acts chapter 2, verse 37. It says, when the people heard this, when the people heard everything that Peter had to say, it says that they were cut to the heart and asked Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Now, I want you to think about what it means to be cut to the heart. We talk a lot here at Soma Church about how the heart is the seat of our emotions. Like, our heart is where we experience all the feels. You guys know what I'm talking about? Okay. When Peter quotes the prophet Joel up in verse 21 and says, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I'm sure that there were those in the crowd who were feeling depressed and wanted to be saved from their depression. There might have been people that were feeling anxious, and Peter's word gave them hope of being delivered from their anxiety. I remember the day that I surrendered my life to Jesus. I too was cut to the heart because at that time I was struggling with abandonment. I was struggling with deep rejection issues, and the idea of being accepted into the beloved, Ephesians chapter 1, that's what motivated me to come to Jesus. That day, Peter brought a message of hope, and I bet there was an alcoholic in the crowd that day that was one binge weekend away from losing his family and was desperate to be delivered from that addiction. And that's okay. I think it's pretty normal for our motivation to come to Jesus be more about our needing him. I think that's okay. But Peter's answer to that question, what do we do, wasn't admit your need. His answer to that question was repent of your sin. Verse 38, Peter replies, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Notice that repenting, to repent, is step one to become a Christian, to be saved. And I'll say this, to have the church that you want to have, every member must, number one, repent of their sins. Every member must repent of their sins. I got to say, this is actually one of the ways that the church has drifted. By and large, we have failed to call people to repentance. And what we have done is we have taught people that they can come into the kingdom of light, but not actually have to leave the kingdom of darkness. And that's just not right. Peter says, step one for salvation is to repent of your sins. Now, I don't feel like I have to exhaust this topic because we do talk about repentance all the time here at Soma Church, right? About leaving your old lives behind, okay? So I'll just reiterate that if you want to be a part of a great church, you have to have a repentant heart. You have to come out of the darkness. You have to leave that old life of sin and rebellion behind. Amen. And call other people to repentance. Brother, that's not who you are anymore. You've been rescued out of the darkness and brought into his marvelous light. That's not you anymore. I encourage you in the name of Jesus, stop doing that thing. Be who God has called you to be. Amen, saints. You know it's okay to call a brother or a sister to repentance. Repent. You can even yell it. Repent! Right? There was an episode of Little House on the Prairie when John Ritter, how many of you remember John Ritter? John Ritter was playing a preacher in that episode. And that's what he would do. Repent! So me and my family, we say that all the time when someone does something wrong. Repent! Because you got to scoop it. Anyway, I digress. Does everybody understand my meaning so far, though? We won't have the church that we want until we become the church that Jesus wants. Peter said, repent. John the Baptist said, repent. And Jesus' message was one of repentance. So the first way that we got to church it up is to repent of our sins. Let's keep going. Verse 38, again, he says, repent. And then he says, be baptized. I'm not going to hang out here very long, but every believer, every born-again Christian needs to be, number two, baptized in water. Jesus commands those who have surrendered their lives to him to be baptized. Now, you guys know that baptism doesn't save you, but it is a public testimony that you have surrendered your life to Jesus. That's what all that's about. Okay? And this is why there are some churches that require baptism for you to become a member. There are even some churches that make you get rebaptized to be a member of their church. It's like, it sounds like trust issues to me. Like, you don't believe me? It's like, we just need to make sure. It's like, I don't even know. It's kind of crazy, right? Now, Soma does not require people to be baptized in order to become members of this church. Okay, and we certainly don't require people to be rebaptized, all right? But we do strongly urge people to take that step of obedience because, one, Jesus commanded it. And then, two, for what it symbolizes. The old me is dead and buried, and the new me is alive in Christ. Amen, saints. And so there's a lot of people in the room. Has everybody been baptized? You been baptized? If you haven't, why not? My experience, I have found that there are three reasons why people have not been baptized yet. One, they just didn't understand that they needed to be. Okay, well, now everybody understands you need to be, right? But sometimes they just haven't had the opportunity yet. It's like, man, I was just saved on Friday. Baptisms ain't till Sunday. Give me a minute, you know? So sometimes you just hadn't had the opportunity yet. We get that. You know, you understand what I'm saying. But here's what's crazy. In my experience, I've been a pastor for 25 years or more, okay? I have found that there are some people that refuse to be baptized, believe it or not. And sometimes it's some sort of weird philosophy going on in their head. They're like, well, baptism, you know, really, the earth revolves around the sun and then the Orion's belt, you know. It's like, what are you even talking about? Just be baptized, man, right? Sometimes it's not about weird philosophies. Sometimes it's just about insecurities. Well, I don't want to be up in front of all those people. It's like, bro, that's the point. That is the whole point of baptism, is that you are telling your community, the one that you've left behind, and the one that you are coming into, I have surrendered my life to Jesus. The old guy's gone. The new guy is on his way. Amen, saints? And listen, I'll tell you this. You will never see a church be what it could be and what it should be if the sacrament of baptism is not a priority. Peter says, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And then he says, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, we've already spent 2 weeks talking about the Holy Spirit, so I'm not going to hang out here either. I just want to remind you that every person who surrenders to Jesus receives the Holy Spirit. Okay, but how many of you know there's a big difference between receiving the Holy Spirit and surrendering to the Holy Spirit? Yes, there is. And I can promise you, we won't have the church that we want to have, and Jesus ain't going to get the church that he wants until the members of that church are, number three, surrendered to the Holy Spirit. Again, we've taught all about that just a couple of weeks ago. You can go back, you can watch, and you can listen about what that means, surrendering to and having a relationship with the Holy Spirit. But we're going to keep going. Verse 39, Peter says, this promise belongs to you and your children, to all who are far off, to all whom the Lord our God will call to himself. And then verse 40, it says, with many other words, Peter testified and Peter urged the people, be saved from this corrupt generation. Verse 41 says, those who embraced his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to the believers that day. Okay, so it sounds like 3,000 people repented of their sins and were baptized that day, on the day of Pentecost, which is amazing. Wouldn't you have loved to have seen that revival moment? Would have been amazing. But look what it says next. This is Acts chapter 2, verse 42, which is where all the goodness about the early church really begins. Remember, people say, we need to be in Acts 2. Some people will say, we need to be in Acts 2:42 church, because this is where the model begins unfolding. Okay? It says in verse 42, it says, they devoted themselves. Okay, we need to pause and we need to ask, who are the they? It is the 3,120 people that were now born again, spirit-filled followers of Jesus Christ, okay? Remember, there were 120 people who waited patiently for the gift that the Father had promised, the Holy Spirit, and then 3,000 people got saved. That's basically some really easy math, right? 3,120, okay? And these people, it says that they devoted themselves. Now, I want you to think about something, and sometimes we don't think in these ways, but these people were the first members of the body of Christ. These 3,120 people were the very first members of his church, of the church. And then take that a little further. Think about this. These people were the very first members of the very first local church there in Jerusalem. Isn't that cool? It's pretty amazing. I don't know. I love that picture. It's like the firsts of a thing are always fascinating to me. Now, a lot of these people that were there left to go home. Remember, there all these people had gathered in the city of Jerusalem for the feast of Pentecost. And so many of them went back home. They took the gospel that they had just heard with them, and they would have done what? They would have established congregations, local assemblies in their area, which is awesome. But a lot of people stayed there in Jerusalem. And I'm talking about a lot of people said, we ain't going home. Something is going on right here. And so they stayed. They literally relocated to Jerusalem from wherever they were from. And it tells us here that all of these people devoted themselves. I want to show you this word devoted in the original, because it means more than just devoted, more than what our brains can comprehend. It means they gave steadfast attention to. They were earnest towards. They were constantly diligent with. I love this last one. To attend assiduously all the exercises. I love that. Now, a much easier way to say that is these people immediately began to church it up, all right? These people gave steadfast attention to, look at that, the apostles' teaching, which just means the preaching and the teaching of the word. By the way, that would have included Jesus' teaching and going through the Old Testament, which is obvious. It's what points to Jesus, but that's what the teaching, the apostles' teachings would have been about. They steadfast attention to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship. Now, I got to show you this word here too, because in the 90s, this was like a buzzword. In the 90s, everybody was about this word, and they would use it and say it all the time. That's the word koinonia, okay? And it means community. So the churches would use that. Here at our church, we are all about the koinonia, you know. And so I would say it all the time because I thought, I got saved in the 90s. So it was all new to me. And I thought, man, all I got to do to sound spiritual is say koinonia. So I show up to church. Hey, we're going to get some of that koinonia today, you know. And there were churches that were started that they even called their church Koinonia Church, which I think is a great name. I considered Koinonia for our church, but our heart is to function as the body, and so that's why we called it soma, the Greek word for body. It says that they gave steadfast attention to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to koinonia. The thing about this word is it means more than just community. Look at these other two words, because this is really what it's about. It means partnership. It means participation. They gave steadfast attention to participating in what was going on. Another way you could say it is everyone engaged in the life of the church, potlucks and all. He goes on and says, steadfast attention to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, and the breaking of bread. Breaking bread was a phrase, it was a common phrase in that language, and it really could mean two things. It could mean we're just going to share a meal together. We're going to go have lasagna, all right? But breaking bread also meant to take communion. I believe this is referring to taking communion because these first four things we see here are things that they did. They are consistent with people gathering together for worship. Look at the fourth thing. Apostles' teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and the fourth one is, and to prayer. In the original Greek, it actually says to the prayers, just like it says the breaking of the bread. So both of these two are referring to something a little more formal. This is something when people got together. They did when they gathered together for worship. Okay? So listen. These first four things tell us that these 3,120 people churched it up by going to church. And I don't care what anyone says. Jesus wants the members of his church to, number four, attend corporate gatherings. He just does. It's funny how some would say, even Christians would say, that Christians don't have to go to church. And they'll actually point to an early church model to prove their point. It's like, you are clearly not reading the word, because they went to church, right? In fact, in that culture, the culture that we're studying about and reading about right here, in that culture, they went to worship like once a day. You guys remember how earlier we said it's important to understand these cultural caveats? This is one of those. There is no way people could go to church every day in this culture. I mean, I guess we could, but the rhythms of our lives and our society are not set up in that way. And so in that respect, we can't function the exact same way that the early church did, right? But going to church does need to be a priority in our lives. Hebrews chapter 10 says that we should consider how to stir one another up to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day of the Lord drawing near. The implication is that instead of making a habit of not meeting, we should be thinking, oh, we need to meet. Why? Because I personally need to be stirred up for love and good deeds. And I might have a buddy that needs to be stirred up to love and good deeds. And I need some encouragement. Maybe I could be an encouragement to someone else. And that is what that gathering is for, so that the saints could be built up and encouraged. Are you guys picking up what I'm laying down? Okay, we talk about that all the time, actually. So let's keep going. Verse 43 says, a sense of awe came over everyone. And the apostles performed many wonders and signs. I love this. It says that there was a sense of awe. Can you imagine what our gatherings would look like if the saints consistently attended? Like, there was a consistent group of people in attendance, and those people had repentant hearts and were surrendered to the Holy Spirit. Can you imagine? And I'm not just talking about our church. I'm talking about the churches in America, right? Could you imagine if at every church gathering there were a consistent, I'm talking about like they consistently came, consistent group, not the shifting and some weeks it's them people and some weeks it's them people. No, it's a consistent group of people attending who had hearts of repentance and were surrendered to the Holy Spirit. It would be a game changer. Am I wrong? By the way, it says that the apostles performed many signs and wonders, but eventually, so did a lot of other people. Amen? Now, I know it's 12:40. You guys aren't checking out on me, are you? Are y'all not like, but we literally have a reservation at Taco Bell for one. I want y'all to hear this. This is important, especially in light of how the Holy Spirit moved today. I think it's super, super important. Surely I'm not the only one hungry to see these things. I think we will the more we church it up. Okay, let's keep going though. Verse 44, listen, it says that all of the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods, they shared with anyone who was in need. This is about giving and generosity. I personally believe that Jesus wants the members of his church to, number five, generously give. Generously give. And boy, I tell you, people can get worked up about this topic. It can get really weird when it comes to talking about giving to the church. I wonder if people who want to be that Acts 2 model of a church realize that these people didn't just tithe. Tithe means 10%. You guys know that, right? These people didn't just tithe. These people gave everything they had. They sold their stuff so that other people could have food and shelter and clothing, right? Isn't that what we're reading here? Okay, so here is a cultural caveat. We can't expect, we can't ask people to sell their possessions and give everything they have. That would be dumb. Okay? Now, if the Lord ever speaks to you to do that, you probably ought to do it. It's not good to disobey God. He will kill you. No, I'm just kidding. He won't kill you. You need to obey God if he tells you to do anything. And there have been people that have existed on this earth. God spoke to them about selling everything and giving it to the poor or whatever. I'm just trying to tell you that God may, listen, 100 people in this room, God will most likely not tell any of us to sell everything we own and give it away. But he 100% requires us to generously give. Agreed? Let's keep going. Verse 46 says, with one accord, they continued to meet daily in the temple courts. Okay, now this is kind of a circle back around statement. It's reaffirming that these people all agreed that they should church it up. Okay, they were unified on how important it was for them to gather. And for them, listen, culturally, it was possible for them to go to church once a day. For us, it's just not. It's not our rhythm. With one accord, they continued to meet daily in the temple courts and to break bread from house to house, sharing their meals with gladness and sincerity of heart. What is this saying? It's saying that they met in smaller groups. It says that they met in small groups, in homes. This time it says break. Did you notice it says they broke bread together? This time this refers to sharing a meal together. In fact, it says sharing their meals with gladness and sincerity of heart. In other words, they enjoyed living life together. They enjoyed doing life together. Families and families, friends and friends. I personally believe that one of the most important ways to church it up is to, number six, commit to a small group. With all my heart, I believe that. To commit to a small group. My first discipleship, once I became a believer, I received in a small group. The first accountability that I was ever given in my life, and boy, I needed it, was in a small group. I was equipped to lead worship in a small group. That was the starting place. And Melissa and I have always been a part of small groups. Now that we are leaders, we lead lots of small groups. If I wasn't a leader, I would still be in a small group. Why? Because I see and understand the value of it. If you're here, I want you to understand that, listen, I know that you come on the weekends and the teaching is out of this world. I get that. But listen, this is not the end all. This is only part of it. It is important to engage in smaller groups of discussion and prayer and accountability. Amen, saints. Okay, let me add one more. Isn't it true that in any culture, in every culture, it takes people working together to get things done? Isn't that right? So think about your small group meeting. We're going to have some bread and we're going to have some butter. Well, who's going to break the bed? Break the bed. I will break the bed if I go into your room and start jumping on it. I've done that before. I've broken some beds. No. Who is going to bake the bread is what I'm trying to say. And you can't have bread without butter, so who's going to be churning the butter? You guys understand what I'm saying? Who's going to set the table? Who's going to get all the communion stuff together, right? So we can have communion. Who's going to sweep the floor? Because nobody can just not eat communion without getting crumbs all over the place, right? So we got to have somebody to sweep the floor. Who's going to scoop the donkey poop out of the parking lot, right? That was probably more their issue back then. If you got donkey poop in your parking lot, you probably got other problems. But you guys understand what I'm telling you? According to Acts chapter 2, and I want you to hear me. According to Acts chapter 2, the early church, there were no spectators. There were only participators. There was koinonia, true koinonia happening. Everyone was working together as one. And I think I can say confidently, And even biblically, that the only way any of us will have the church that we want, the only way that Jesus is going to get the church that he wants, is if everyone, number seven, finds some way to serve. Find some way to serve. Now listen, I understand that we are supposed to serve our families. And we're supposed to serve the community. I get that. But I am specifically talking about churching it up in the area of serving in the local church. You know, in most churches, 20% of the people do all the work. 20%, this is statistically proven, 20% of the people do all the work, while 80% come in and sit and partake and leave. Statistically, 20% generously give, while 80% of the people enjoy all the things, but they never contribute anything. And honestly, that's just awful, isn't it? I mean, that's awful. I've always been really proud of our church family, because for our church families, it's actually the exact opposite. 80% of the people give and serve, and it's actually statistically an anomaly. I've been told that before. That's an anomaly. I was like, you don't know my people. Now, does Soma have a percentage of people who don't contribute? Unfortunately, yes. My prayer is that one day 100% of our people will be unified and devoted the way that the early church was. Amen, saints. I don't know about you, but I love the church. I love the church. I love the body of Christ. I love our church. And I want our church to be as healthy and strong as it can possibly be. And that's why, as often as I can, I remind our people to have repentant hearts, to be baptized if you hadn't been baptized yet, to surrender to the Holy Spirit. And then as far as those last four things, the way we say them here at Soma is be here, live here, serve here, and give here. That's how we encourage people to church it up at Soma Church. When we say be here, what we're saying is to be here in our weekend services and other special events as much as your schedule will allow. Remember the cultural caveats. Not everybody can be here every week. It's just impossible. Sometimes you got soccer games, sometimes you got vacations, and we need that stuff. So we're not going to be here every week, but as much as our schedule will allow, we come to church. We gather corporately. When we say live here, we are talking about being a part of a small group, attending a small Bible study or something, some sort of breakdown of the bigger, and getting involved in other life-giving things. We have encounters and things like that. Again, as much as your schedule allows, live here. When we say serve here, we're talking about serve in ways that help this body flourish, but also will engage people who are unchurched when they come in and they see a greeter at the door smiling and saying, I think you're the best thing since sliced bread. When then they feel that. When we say give here, listen, we're a church, and I don't make apologies for this, we're a church that believes in tithing. We believe in tithing. The scripture talks about tithing and free will offerings. Listen, if you can't tithe, that's not your thing yet. Okay, there's bigger fish to fry, right? But we do believe in that. And so when we say give here, we're just saying have the heart of Jesus and be a generous giver. Contribute something. Maybe money's not what you can contribute at this time. It's like, okay, but you might could sweep those communion crumbs off the floor. Then do that. That would be awesome. Does everybody understand my heart? Be here, live here, serve here, give here. This, as a church, is how we try to get as close as we can to an Acts 2 model of the early church. Are we perfect at it? Not yet, but we're getting there, amen? And our hope is that we will experience, as we church it up, what the early church did. And this is verse 47. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Look up here. added to their number daily those who were repenting of their sins, being baptized, receiving the Holy Spirit, and actively engaging the church so that more people could repent of their sins, be baptized. You guys see the trend? That's what God wants for his people. Amen. All right, let's stand and let's pray this together, all right? I want us to pray this out loud together, right? Put a hand in the air so I know that you mean it. Repeat after me. Jesus, help me to church it up. Amen.